हेलो, हे हाय एवरीवन, गुड इवनिंग। दिस
हाय हाय अमित।
इज स्टार्टिंग अ मिनट, जस्ट गिव मी 1 मिनट, जस्ट स्टार्ट। Okay, so let's start. So yesterday what we did was we were talking on the looping parts, right? So we had talked about the data frames that we were working, and we had talked about how you can write the if-else conditions, and then we were doing the loops yesterday, right? The for loops that we have in the R. So this is what we had did. So today what we will be doing is we will be continuing ahead from there, where we will talk about the while loops, right? So before I start with the while loops, let's do a quick small question over here. Right, and Deepa, your question: how to delete a row or a column? How to delete a word? What is that second thing? PAR value.
No, the particular value, like one value, multiple values, and
See,
a
but
row
apparently,
wise, yeah.
suppose you have this iris data set, right? So I'm just saving it in one variable. So what we do is, this is iris data set that we have. So just store it in one of the variables. So what happens is, when you have to delete a row or delete a column, this is just the column and indexing that you use. So like for adding a row and for deleting a for adding a row for deleting for adding a row or a column, what we did was we were using cbind and rbind.
R
So
bind, yeah.
the same concept goes in the same concept goes in your the
Matrix,
data
everything.
frames also.
Okay.
The same concept goes in the data frames also. So now, for example, if you want to delete a row, to delete a row or column, we don't have any functions for that. We just have to use the indexing concept only for that. We just have to use slicing indexing that we had done. So that is the only thing that is used again over there. Like for example, if this is the data set iris, right, and you say that you want to from this iris one data set, suppose you say you want to remove the last column, right? You don't need this column of species, so you will just be using that concept of slicing and indexing. I will say iris, suppose if I say iris one and I don't want to see the last column, right? So I will say I want to see all the rows and columns. I want to see only from 1 to 4, correct? So if I run this, we have 5 columns. If I will run this now, so what is going to happen is, this is going to give me in the output, if I'll show you in the view, right? So I don't have the species column inside it. So what we do is we simply reassign the same thing and we override the variable with this. So if I'm going to write this, so if you see now, this how this is where now in this data set, that column is gone. So I don't have that column now. So that indexing part is just reassigned to the same variable. If you want to remove the rows, right? Suppose you want to remove a row, so you will have to give that the row number that you are planning to remove now. So for example, you say you want to remove the first row. So what we do is we say iris 1. Now if I say that in this data set, iris 1, minus 1 and all the columns, right? So if I show you now, you are left with 149 observations. So first row is gone. So you don't have the first row in this data, right? So that is, so for that purpose, it's slicing and indexing.
Now, can you explain it again, this minus 1? See, minus first one, I got it. It is fetching all the rows and only 4 columns.
So in the second one, what I'm doing is, if I say 1 comma this, what will the meaning of that?
If first I say row.
First row, all the columns.
Yeah.
When you write minus against it, that means except first row, everything.
Except first row, everything. Okay.
Yeah. So if you want to remove a particular row, you can say minus C. You want to remove the row number 2, row number 5. So now that would mean except the second and fifth row, all the things will be deleted. Except second and fifth row, all the things will be visible. So that means that data, now these 2 and 5 will be deleted from that data frame. So if I now run this, you will now see this iris data set. So this was, right? So what we have done is we just remove that second and fifth right now from here. You see 147 entries. You see we had 153, those are deleted. And you can't delete a particular value, right? So a particular value you cannot delete because it's a tabular structure. You can only update it. Suppose if you say that you have this data point, you want to change this value. So deleting means you are setting it to NA, right? So what is the row number and column number? So if you come over here, so the row number gets, right? You have the row number 1 and you are saying that, in the row number 1 and column number 2, you want to set it to NA. So what we do in that scenario is we simply come up over here. You will say that in iris data set, iris 1, row number 1, column number 2, whatever value you have, you want to set it to NA. So that way the data gets updated to NA that way. Right? So it is now blank. NA.
Can you show that code once again? Is it the same thing for vectors?
No, the same thing for vectors. The vectors
If I include this minus 1, it means that exclude this particular row or column, right?
Correct.
Can I give the range also here? Minus C of 2 colon 5 from row to 5, 2 to 5. Will it work? Okay. Yeah, getting it. And one last question, Amit. You told us some of the inbuilt data sets, right? Data of if we run that, we'll get cars, everything, species, everything. I saw, I couldn't get how to add the header name for that. If you run view of empty cars, right? For each and every row of unique car values, I got the columns MPG cylinder. If I want to add the header for the car names as cars, is it any way possible?
I didn't get your question. Can you come again?
See, if you run view of empty cars, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. See, all these columns have the headers. If I want to add the header for the row, for the first one.
So these are not columns, these are row names.
Yeah, row names. If I want to add a header for row, is it possible?
Not for the row names. It is the indexing column. So indexing column, they don't have a column. Otherwise, it will become a part of the data set.
Okay, because in the assignment you gave, I couldn't get the exact value. So I used that dim names. I got the index of that row and I got that output. So I thought of asking, is there any other way? Okay. This is all from my end. Thank you so much.
Hello, Amit.
Hello.
Amit, I have a question, Amit.
Please.
Okay, I have a question in round off.
Question from?
Round off. In data frame, question 10.
Okay. Can you share your screen?
Sure. The question is, this is the question.
So you have added a column of performance, right? So
yes. I have a column of performance here. So, I mean, when I try to round off it, I'm getting only the performance column. So others are going off. So I just wanted to check with you.
Can you just show me the data set? The complete data set once. Install it up a little bit. Huh? So you have the performance column over there. No, so you access? Are. You want to now round this performance to two decimal places, right?
Yes, yes.
So you will say DF dollar performance. Write it.
DF
dollar. So what is the name that you gave? You gave it a name DF, right? DF dollar.
Yes, yes, yes.
Like performance. Hyphen, that arrow sign. So round off. Round, then you want to round the same thing, DF dollar performance.
Okay.
But otherwise, you know what was happening was we didn't perform another, that previous performance got now comma 2. Now you check it.
Okay, got it. And I have one more question. So, I got the Ismail, okay, so this is the table is fine, but I don't know how to change to gender, like male, female, and change Ismail to sex and true or false into male and female.
No, is it asking the question?
Yeah, so this is the question. So it is supposed to be like 6MF, MMF.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, if I...
So, you should have read the gender beforehand only, na? You could have said that the gender column, I just create a vector. So, what you do is just create a vector over here, a new vector. No, in the next line. In the next line, just add gender. And assign it the arrow. And just create male, female.
Okay, so if I give F, it is saying it's a wrong argument. Okay, I'll show you.
You come in the double quotes.
Oh, okay, fine. I tried it. So since it get it's a wrong argument, so I thought it's something else.
Okay. It's nice created.
Yeah.
So now you'll have to add this in the data.
Okay.
So you can now say, for example, you can do column line.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay.
So now, you know, today what we're going to do is we're going to talk about the while loop. So see, in while loop, what happens is basically this is a loop that runs till the condition is true. This is how this while loop works. For example, I declare a variable, value of A. The value of A is 1. I've created a variable over here, and into this, what I've done is I have assigned a value as 1. So now I write a loop. I'm saying while A is less than equal to 5, print hello. Okay. So now what is happening is, what is the value of A? The value of A is 1. Now I have written a loop that till the time, right? Till the time the value of A is less than or equal to 5, it should keep doing the same thing over here, right? It should keep running the loop for us. Now, definitely what will happen is, when the loop will run for the first time, the value of A will be 1, condition is true, it will print hello. Then again it will come to this loop, right? It will again check what is the value of A. So value of A is still 1, which is less than 5. It will again print hello. Now the value of A will always remain 1, right? So if you run this loop, what is going to happen is, there will be an infinite loop that will be created. See, it is running hello, hello again and again, right? Because every time what is happening is, the code is coming back to the while condition. It is checking the condition. And every time the condition is turning out to be true, so the code has gone into infinity loop. I will have to stop, you know, interrupt the R that, okay, stop the code, because there was some trouble that had happened. So in the while loop, you know, what you have to do is, you have to increment the value of A. Inside the loop, I am saying A equals to A plus 1. So when the code started, at that point in time, the value of A was 1. And when it went inside the loop, it became A plus 1. So when the first time the loop run, the value of A becomes 2. Then it becomes 3. Then it becomes 4, 5. The moment the value of A becomes 6, the code will stop. Right? So if I run this, the code only runs 5 times and the code stops, because now the value of A became 6. You can see this also over here in the variable, that A's value became 6. Now 6 is not less than equal to 5, it is greater than 5. Condition gets failed and the code stops. Getting it, everyone? Okay. So if I give you a task now, if I say, print the factorial of a number. Using while loop. Can you all do that? Done anyone? Right. So what we do is, so we define a number over here, right? Suppose we want to print the factorial of a number 5. So what we do is we'll have to define a variable over here. Suppose like 1. So I will say while num is greater than equal to 1. Right? What I would like to do is I will simply like to say fact equals to fact multiplied by num. Right, and I will just keep subtracting 1 from there. The num equals to num minus 1. So what I'm doing right now is, if you see, I have declared the variable for which I want to find the factorial, that is 5. So I have to assign or declare a variable, that is fact over here, right? Fact I'm assigning it as 1. So what will now happen is, when I run this loop, right? Now when I run this loop, so what is my condition? That if the number is greater than or equal to 1, it should go inside the loop. So at this time, at the starting of the loop, the value of number is 5. Condition is true, it will go inside the loop. So I am saying fact is equal to fact into num. What is fact? 1. That will become, fact will become 5 into 1, that is 5. Now I have subtracted 1 from this. So the value of num becomes 4. Condition is true. Now we are going to say fact into num. The value of fact was 5. So 5 into 4, that will give me 20. Right? Same way, 20, then into 3, then 2 into 1. So what will happen is, I will get the factorial of that number. Now what I do over here is, I will simply have to say print num. This is the number that I want to print now. Sorry, not num, fact. This is what I have to print now. So num will become 0 only. So that is 1. Everyone, are you all sorted on this? Suppose, you know, now what I want to do is, the output that we are generating, the output number 120 that we have generated over here. Suppose what I'm trying to say now is, I want to generate this output as like this. The factorial of 5 is 120. Right now, I have just printed that number only, 120. But I have the different expectation that I want to print the output in this format, that the factorial of 5 is 120. So how can I do that? Right? So in this, you know, what we do is, we will actually have to use some, you know, like a function over here. This function is like concatenate function. Right? This is a concatenate function that we have. I mean, it's not exactly concatenate. It's a type of the concatenation that it is going to do for us. What we have is, we have a function like paste and paste 0. We have two functions with us, paste and paste 0. So now let me tell you what these two functions are. So what happens is basically paste is a function. If you use this function, it automatically puts a space if you have defined two data points, right? Like if I say print paste Sachin comma Tendulkar, right? So it's like concatenated function. So I'm saying I want to print Sachin comma Tendulkar. So paste is going to concatenate them. So if you will see the output, output comes as Sachin space Tendulkar. That means by default, this function has inserted a space between the values. If I use the same thing over here, instead of print, instead of paste, I use paste zero. Okay, so what this will do is this will not insert or this will not add a space over there. It is simply going to say Sachin Tendulkar without a space. Now, what I wanted to do was I wanted to print the output in a little better way. So I'm going to say paste the factorial of, then I say num, which is a variable, right? So is so we see the factorial of num is fat. So now if I write this condition, right, it is going to print the output, the factorial of num is fat, right? So basically, you know, but num can, you know, can create a problem because its value will get changed to zero by the time the loop runs. So let's just keep it as, for now, the factorial is this. Fact means whatever the calculation that had happened. So now if I run it over here, the factorial is 120, right? So I have combined a text value and the variable name so that I get a output in the form of a statement.
Hi, Amit. I'm getting an error with the paste function.
Can you share the code over here on the chat?
Yeah. Oh, sorry, not this one. Paste function. Yes.
You're written opposite way. First, you will have to write print. Inside that, you have the paste.
Okay. I'm also getting an R code execution error.
Sorry?
R code execution error. Error retrieving help. R code execution error.
You know, actually, this latest version, it has actually a bug, right? That the temporary folders, they get deleted. So you will have to just open this and close the R and open it again. It will start the
properly then. Okay.
Shall we move forward?
So without using paste, if we just use a plus sign, that so actually,
the plus sign means that the previous code that you wrote, na, that somewhere was not ended properly. So in the console window, press escape key so that you get an arrow and then run the code again.
No, I'm saying you're saying to use concatenate this paste function. If you want to print the factorial is 120. But I'm saying if you scroll up in the code and instead of this paste function, if you just write print and don't use the paste function, just write the factorial is plus fact or comma fact, that won't work for concatenation.
I didn't get your point.
So if you remove the paste, if you remove the paste and the brackets and just add plus after the factorial is.
This one's.
Yeah.
Write this out your memory because we have this ampersand and all. Let us try it out.
Okay, and instead of plus, if we try a comma. That also doesn't work. Okay, so we then have to use paste function. There's no other way to concatenate.
Like, you know, this is something like concatenate part that you have. To combine the two data points.
Okay.
See, now what we will do is, now I'll tell you there's a concept in the R which is called as working directories, right? So what are working directories? Working directories are basically, they are the home folders from where R can access the files directly. Okay, this is something that we call it as working directories now. So when you install R right in your system, so there is a working folder that R automatically creates, right? It's like a folder where R is going to store all its temporary files, or it is going to store all the data that you create by default, as a default, right? That is like a working folder or a working directory that you have. Suppose you write a command get wd, that is get working directory. If you run this, it will show you that path right away, that this is the path where R has created its home folder. Right, so just write this command, that is get working directory. You are checking, this command is to see what is the working directory that you have. So this is the working directory on my system. So same way, if you will write at your end, you will be able to see your working directory on your system. Like wait, that R has created its home folder. Yeah, so it gives the directory path, like the your system, like where that R was installed. So it creates that in the C drive, it creates that folder, it shows you that. Now, if you want to change this path, right? If you want to change the path, what we do in that case is we have a command called setwd. Just give me a second. Huh? here, right? So if you want to change the path, we have a command called setwd, right? So in the setwd, what you can do is you can define any other path if you want, right? And it'll tell you that why you should be doing that, right? Why will you be doing that? So what we do is, now suppose this is a folder that I have. I just copy this folder path and I come to my R now. And I say setwd, the double quotes, you have to give that path. And you have to make a small change, right? When you copy default, this forward slash come like this. You have to change it to backward slash like this. Sorry, I mean the backward slash are coming, because you have to change to forward slash now. So if I run this command now, my working directory is changed. But my working directory is changed just for this session, right? Till the time this R is opened up. For that point of time, my working directory, I have changed it by myself. Now, why I have done it? So the reason is, if suppose you have some files kept over there, right? You have some Excel files, CSV files, or any code, or anything you have, you want to access those files. So it becomes easier when you change that working directory, right? Because you will not have to give the entire path every time. So if any file is kept in that folder, you will be able to retrieve it very quickly without giving any folder path and all, right? That is where the use of the setwd is, right? If you have in this folder, right? Like you can do the same thing from here also. You can change the working directory from here as well. You click on this files, right? You will see three dots. Just come over here. You will see three dots over here. Click on the three dots. Then what you do is you simply go to that folder where that you want to make that as a working directory now. Suppose I come over here and I say this is the folder and I click on open. Then what you do is you have to click on more, set as working directories. Ultimately, the same command R will also execute. R will also do the same thing. And if I want to do anything different, it's just that you have achieved the same thing with the help of GUI instead of writing a code. Right? So this is called as working directory, where you can change the folder path, and which I'll just show you in a second that how it is used. So now what I'm going to do over here is, in this path that I have created, right? In this path that I have created, I'm going to place a file. So I guess you all have one file with you. That is the one of the file that was this P1 UK bank customers, right? Do you all have that? Okay. So just, you know, copy and paste that file in that folder. Just copy and paste that file path, that file UK bank customer in that folder, which you have set it up as your working directory now.
From the GUI, how can we make it as the working directory?
Sorry?
From the GUI, how did you make that after opening the folder, after pressing those three dots and opening the folder? Then how did you make it as the working directory?
First, you select the path and click on more, that is working directory.
Okay.
Okay, shall I move forward? See, now what happened is, suppose if you want to load the data from the CSV file. See, up till now what we have done is we were using the inbuilt data sets. Now if you want to load the data from a CSV file, suppose let's call it as bank data, a variable. We have a function called read.csv. You just have to give the file name. Press P1 tab key and it will be able to pick that file name automatically, that in that folder there is a file name with this that you want. So I just typed P1 and I pressed the tab key, it was able to pick that file. So if I run this now, you will notice that data has been loaded, and again I will be able to see that data over here in this R interface.
There's a read.csv2 also.
Sorry?
Read.csv2.
So that is the same function only. That is the same thing.
Okay, and what do we have for Excel?
So for that, we need a package.
So it can only pick up files which exist in this working directory?
No, if the file is saved in any other location, in that case what will happen is, suppose the file is in this folder, so you will have to give the complete path also. So you will say, okay, the file is in this path. So okay, you will have to do that. Just to avoid that hassle, that instead of giving the file paths every time, because you know when we work on any of the projects, so mostly all the files we place it in one single folder for that project. Right. So I will not have to keep on writing that file path again and again. So this way, this working directory helps us, that I'm now saying that I'm going to pick up the files from this folder only. So it has the access to all the files placed in that folder.
Yeah, it makes it very easy. You just need to know the file name.
You don't have to. This is where it becomes more
user friendly. Simple.
So now from this bank data, right, just quickly try some functions, right? Like the functions that we tried yesterday, end row, end call, summary, str, right? So please try these functions. Yep, working. Anyway. Okay. So now you know what we're going to do is, we are going to explore something called data manipulation. Just a second. So now you know what we're going to do is we're going to talk about data manipulation now, how we can do the data manipulation in R. Now this is something that we are going to do with the help of a package. The package is dplyr, right? So when we talk about data manipulation, right now this is something which will you will find very much similar on the concepts of SQL that we studied. Okay, so what happens in R Python is that we have a variety of packages that are available. So we can use those packages to do various functionalities and tasks right away, right? So there are almost like 17,000 packages that are available in R if I talk about. Okay, so how do we get an access to the packages where you can see them? You see there is a section of packages. So over here, you will see the list of all those packages that are there on your machine. Okay, you will be able to see all those packages over here. So there are certain packages that come preloaded when you install R, but there are certain packages that you can download and install in your R right away, and dplyr is one of them. So how do we install a package? We simply say install.packages and we give the name of that package, like you want to install dplyr. So in the double quotes, this dplyr package name will come and you will have to run this command. So when you run this command, what is going to happen is now R will hit CRAN, right? That is the comprehensive R archive network. It is going to hit that network and it will download that package from there. So all of you please run this command. I already have this, so I won't do it. You just run this command, it will download a package for you.
Amit, after downloading, right, it is showing a path. Do I need to make a note of that or?
No, nothing.
Okay.
After you install it, if you will come in the packages now, if you will just type dplyr, you will be able to see that package name coming up, right? It is saying a grammar of data manipulation. After you install a package, you have to put the package into library. This is what you have to do as the next thing. What is library? Library is nothing. It is just like telling R that you would like to use these functionalities of this package. So for that, you simply say library and the name of that package, dplyr. So what will now happen is this package will come in the library and you see there's a tick mark. Tick mark means now you can use the functionalities of this package. So now what happens is when you close the R, when you will close the R, automatically what R will do is it will unassign it. It will unassign the package from here. It will say, okay, it is removed from the library. So this is something that is going to happen then, right? When you close the R, if you want to unassign it, right? This also you can do, just click on this, or you can click on this again to put it into the library. So again, GUI technique, right? I clicked on it. It again executed the same thing, library command.
Amit, what is the error coming below the following objects are masked from package stats? And
not an error. So this is just a message that is being displayed. So basically what happened is there are a lot of functions which are available in the base package also. So the same functions are available in dplyr, they are available in base packages also. So it just gives you the list of that. That these package,
Same functions are available in stats and base package.
Right.
So stats and base package come preloaded in R?
They are preloaded. Okay. Right, like when you write this sum. You see the package name comes over here. That this function is coming from base package.
Okay.
These functions, they are coming from the dplyr package.
So packages we can understand as a collection of different functions.
Yes.
Package.
Correct. Like the first function that we will explore over here is that is select. Right, the same select command that we used to write in SQL. If I say select, my name of the data set is bank data. Now suppose in the output, right, in the output you only want to see some limited columns. You want to see name, gender and age. So what you will do is you will come over here, you will simply write that you want to see the name, gender, age. If you're going to run this command, it will show you only those three columns in the output.
Amit, how did it open this bank data for you in a separate tab?
Sorry?
I didn't get that bank data in a separate tab. How did
this,
it?
Over this?
Yeah.
You just click on this variable. So if you click on it, it opens it up.
Okay.
Okay. You can also give column numbers. You can say select bank data. You want to see the column number 1, 3, 5. So it will show you column number 1, 3, and 5 over there.
This bank data is not showing in my global environment.
Over here?
Yeah.
Have you executed this command? When we were saying read.csv?
Yeah.
Can you share your screen?
Sure. This line you're saying, right? I'd executed it.
The file name, it was an error. So it will come in the double quotes. The file name comes in the double quotes.
So this environment is empty.
Do you have this file in that folder?
Yeah. No.
Just write the command. Get your working directory is not changed. What is your working directory that you're using?
I had assigned this as the working directory, and this file is also available here. I had assigned this R folder as the working directory.
Can you scroll it up?
This one?
I don't see the. No. So just scroll it up.
Okay.
On this side, in the folder side, file section.
Below.
No, files
here?
Only.
Files only? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, can you scroll this up?
Yeah.
The file is not here, na? UK Bank Customers.
It is UK Bank Customers. See, it is coming down because there are other files also in this folder. So
you can just, can you increase the size of this? So people, UK Bank Customers, because right now what I see, the issue is this only, that you don't have that file in this.
File is there in this folder and I've signed it as working directory, but it doesn't come in my environment.
I think she didn't use CSV.
.csv. It's
not CSV. Is missing.
Where? Oh.
That file name.
Catch. Thanks. Okay. Yeah, now I can see it. So if I press this, then cool. Thank you. Stop sharing.
So what we've done is, I was executing this select command. The select command is just to see the columns. And if you wrap this inside view, if you put this inside view, so what it does is it shows you in the tabular format as well. Okay, and you know, in this select command, you can also say, like, if you say select bank data, comma, you say -1, -2. That means except -1, except first and second column, everything will be shown to you in the output. What happened?
Full stop instead of comma. Comma, full stop instead of
there comma. There is a dot after one.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, then you have a function in this that is arrange, right? Arrange is a function that you can use for sorting the data, to sort the data. Like, for example, the output that you have, right? Suppose you want to sort that data by gender. So you can simply say arrange the name of that data set, bank data, and you would have to just give the name as that you want to sort the data by gender. Right. So if you will see, let me go in the view. So if I run this, you will see now the data is sorted by gender now, female, and then you will have the males. Right. So data is sorted. So by default, it is ascending. If you want the data to be descending order, so what you can do in that case is you can just write DESC. So you can write DESC on this, so it will make it descending order. So now first you get the male and then the female.
-1 and -2 are removed the first two rows. -1 and -2 in that view select data, it had removed the first two rows.
This select bar?
Yeah.
No, this is for columns. The -1 and -2 will remove the first two columns.
Okay.
So select is, we use, like, remember we used to say select star from table name.
Yeah.
Star, you mean all the columns. If you say select name, if you say select order ID, category and subcategory, it used to show you only three columns. So that is the same operation that is happening over here. That I am saying except these -1, -2. These two columns, I want to see everything.
Okay. And you'll tell us about rows also later, right? How to remove the rows or see, view certain rows. Sorry? For rows.
So I'll be coming to rows. I'll be coming to that. So this is how you can sort, right? And if you want to sort the data by two columns, that is also possible. If you say arrange bank data, suppose you want that the data should be sorted first by gender, then you want the data to be sorted by balance. So that is totally fine. Now the column will be sorted on two bases. First in the ascending order of gender, and within gender, it will be on the basis of balance. Okay. Now we have a command in this, that is filter. Now filter is, this is like where clause, right? For example, if you say that you have the data, you say filter, the data set name is bank data. And I say that in the bank data, what I would like to do now over here is, I want to see only the data of the female. So you will simply say gender equal to female. So you will be able to see that data now. It shows you only the data of female now.
Amit, can we use two conditions here? Sorry? The AND operator. Can we use two conditions here?
No, you can do that. So okay. The same thing, if you want to use two conditions in this, suppose you want to say you want to see the filter,
mm-hmm.
bank data. Now, first of all, you want to see the data where gender is equals to male. If you put a comma, right? If you put simple plain comma over here, you say you want to see that data where gender is male. And I'm saying region is equals to England. So now this will work like a AND operator. So simple okay. comma, right? If you want to use OR condition, so you will have to use that operator over here. That is the pipe operator. So you'll have to put this pipe operator.
Okay, this simple comma for the AND, pipe for yeah. the OR. Okay.
You can use comma also. And if you want to write AND also, that is also fine.
Okay.
But comma will also work. So both okay. the things are. So, right, Radhika, so this is how you filter the rows, also, right? This gives you an idea now. So, you see, now we are getting the data based on the filtration.
Yeah, but then there was, if we can remove top end rows or bottom end rows or rows condition.
See, technically, you know what happened is we never do that, right? When we talk about the data sets now, because when we have the structured data that we get, right? Like if I have a bank data with me. So hardly there will be a scenario where you will be saying that I want to remove the first row, second row, the third row. Correct? Because that is a tabular format of a data. So we say the data is stored in a proper structured way. So you can just remove the data based on a condition. But if you still want that, you know, you want to remove a particular row, you want to say that I want to remove that data row only. So one technique was that we will start discussing in the starting of the session where you will use the indexing technique. Otherwise, you also have a slice function in this. So there is a slice function. So if you say slice, okay, and you say bank data. Okay, so in this, what you do is you can give, suppose you say from 1 to 5, right? Now what this will do is, this will only show you the data from 1 to 5 now, correct? So only first 5 rows. You want to see starting from the 5th row up till the last row. So you say number of rows that you have in this bank data. Now it will show you the data starting from the 5th row up till the last row. So that way you can use it.
But if you want to make analysis on that data, like this is not just for viewing, but for analysis, then so we could store it in a vector.
not a vector variable. So it's a data frame. So data frame is something that will have this complete data in itself. Like analysis, as in like, suppose, what would you like to do?
So suppose, suppose I want to remove all the rows where the region is England, okay? And then I want to analyze the data on the rest of the set.
So you can do this now, this filtering that we have done. So right. You will say the region is not equal. You can save it into two variable.
For so not equal to, it will just be one equal to sign and one exclamation.
That also will work, and this will also work. This will also work.
Okay. So that will filter the data, and you are going to store it in a variable.
New variable, yes. Mm-hmm. So that will have just the data that you would have filtered. And we will do some analysis also. I'll be showing you, right? We will be grouping the data. We will be joining the data. So those things, we will make the charts also in the R. So those things also we will be doing.
So the slice that you're saying, this is for
remove a bunch of rows. Like this slice is a bunch of rows.
And the one which you had shown earlier, that was for columns. That was not for rows, right?
Select function?
Yeah.
That is for columns.
Yeah.
Okay. If you say 1, 2, that means you only want to see column 1 and 2.
Okay.
Now you see slice function. In the slice, what happens is if I write slice over here, bank data, and I say that I want to see the rows from 1 to 5. So it will show me only first 5 rows. Suppose you want to see the row number 2, 3, 2, 3, 7. So you will say C 2, 3, 7. So it will show you these three rows.
Okay. All right.
Then we have a function in this that is distinct. Now what this distinct will do is gives you unique data, unique values. Suppose you say distinct, the name of the data is bank data. You want to see the unique region. So you will be able to see that, okay, here. Land, Northern Ireland, Wales, and Scotland.
Can you scroll up a bit for that slice syntax? And a little up where you used n rows. Okay.
So it's really dynamic. So suppose I don't know the number of rows. So I'm picking the number of rows from this function itself. That this is 4016. So I'm saying starting from the fifth row up till the last row.
Okay. So even if we update, like with this one, even if we update the data, add some more data to the sheet.
This will work. Yes.
This will work.
Otherwise, it would have become hard-coded.
Also, like how we use view. Is in capital, and when you're using gender or region, that's also in capital, like starting with caps. But when we like slides,
These are functions. So basically, this is because my column names are in that way. So gender, so R is case sensitive. My column name is with capital G, so I will have to write it in the capital G over there.
Okay, but for example, this view function, view need to use V in capital, otherwise, it won't work.
So because write them, that is why I say the functions are defined over there. Some functions have uppercase, some have lowercase. So we have to keep that thing in mind that we are using in a proper case sensitive manner.
Is there a general rule like where to use caps or where to use normal?
That I've seen. Mostly you will find all the functions are, right? I mean, 99% of the functions they start with lowercase only. There are only one or two, very few functions which have uppercase. Every other function that we have explored up till now, they were all starting with lowercase, right? And for summary, the structure, anything, right? So they were all with lowercase only.
There was one rows, one num name rows, where we can name the rows that there the rows are was starting in capital. So there are very few functions which we have probably just remember.
Very few functions where?
We'll just have to remember. There's no, I don't think there's a general.
So I mean, the when you just start using this function on a regular basis, so they already they sit in your mind. That is how we use it.
Okay.
Now we have some more functions inside this, right? Like if I come inside this, suppose if there is another function that we have, that is summarize. Now summarize is a function, is it just if you want to see some sum or average or something like that. Suppose you say summarize, you know, if you all would have noticed, right? All these functions that I am using in the dplyr, they are following a same pattern, right? You use the function, you give the name of the data set, and you just have to give the name of the columns and do your working on that. Now, for example, I want to see summarize. So I'm saying in bank data, I am saying sum. I want to see the sum of sales. So I can say total sales equals to sum of sales. So what this will do is, it's not sum of sales, sum of balance, total balance, right? So I'm going to say total balance equal to sum of balance. So if I write this, so it shows me this is the total balance that we have in the bank. So summarize is a function that we use just to find a quick total, maximum, minimum, those type of things. So if I say summarize bank data and I say max of balance, so it will show you the maximum balance.
What is that summarize all?
Huh?
Summarize all. Because if you click summarize, there are few other options coming, right?
So see, most of the functions, they are similar. You will just find some of the functionalities in terms of, you know, somewhere some delimiters are being used and somewhere, you know, they give you additional feature of giving the header names, column names. That is the things that change. So for similar kind of stuff, you will find many other functions over here.
If I want to find the total customers, is there any count function here?
Length, for that we have length function. So you have count in, basically you will find the count function in the dplyr. Like if you use summarize, right? You say bank data. So you have a count function as a part of a dplyr, right? Count, and you can say count of customer ID, you can say, right? So instead column, maybe you can just use count of gender also. So this will give you. We can draw summarize. Just use length over here. Right, 4016. If you don't understand any function, we have this help function, the help path over here. We can see some examples over here. Count. I guess it will work with Python. Okay. So it's a simple, straightforward function, like where you give that count and data set is bank data and you want to count, suppose, gender, so it does that. So this is how this count is working. So it gives a unique count of each value in this. Otherwise, you want to see a normal count, so that is the length function that you can use.
So it shows the similar result. Length is also like count.
Length is a, it's a normal count. It is just counting the rows only. It gives you the 1000 total count. This count is actually finding the unique values and giving the count of that. That these many male and these many female.
Okay. Since it is giving the number of rows, then is there any difference between n rows and this length? No.
Difference between
the rows, we used a function to fetch the number of rows, right?
So they are like same only because
n row, okay.
N row function will not work on the vector, so over there you will have to use length only because vector will have the rows and all. So that n row and this length technically becomes the same,
okay.
And count, you're saying, will give distinct values of that count.
I mean, like in that gender column, we have two type of genders, right? Male and female. So it is giving me the count of male and female. Suppose if you say count of bank data, right? We have the region in that. If I count it on region, so there are four regions. So it is going to give me that how many times England is there, how many times Scotland is there. It is going to give you that count.
Okay. So it's not like distinct row wise. It's just the names and numbers it's giving.
The number of entries of that particular value.
Number of entries, okay.
Then we have a group by function, right, that we can use. Now, see, group by is a function that we use, like, you know, we already have used in the SQL also to group the data. So group by is something you will use, is used with summarize. So how do we use this function is, I am going to say summarize group by, right, bank data. I want to group the data by region and I want to find the sum of sales, balance, okay. So if you will see now, it gives you that output that in England, total balance is this, Northern Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. So you can see the balance over here. So it's a group by statement. So grouping of the data is being done. So I'm saying that I want to group the data by region and I want to see the sum of balance. So this is where, you know, I think we'll take a pause for today, right? So we have done, you know, functions. So tomorrow we will be continuing on the dplyr only, in which, you know, we will talk about some more stuff, how you can work with the joins, how we will work with the pipe operators, and then we will be starting off with the visualizations.
And how to load Excel files?
For that we need a package. So I'll be showing you that. For that we need a package, read Excel. Try that out, just simply say read Excel package you can install. So this is the name of the package that has to be installed. So once this package is installed, so there is a function called Excel sheets. Like I already have this package with me, read Excel.
Is it the same way how we installed this dplyr? It's a free package.
It will be installed the same way. You have to install this package, put it in the library. Then you simply say, is the function you will get Excel sheets. This read Excel, read underscore Excel. So you have to give the file name, comma, sheet name. Sheets equal to whatever the name of the sheet is. The data will be loaded.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. See you guys tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.